You're probably seeing all over the news and all over social media account after account of people being canceled. This is the product of something called cancel culture. Let's take a look at cancel culture biblically and see if God would agree or disagree with it. Let's talk about that. Yo, what's up guys? My name is Jeff. I make videos just like this nearly every week to make faithful followers of Jesus and equip them to change the world. If that sounds like what you're looking for, do me a favor and hit that subscribe button so you can get all the new videos coming out. Also, if you want to talk about this video or any other video, or you have prayer requests, anything like that, come hang out with me sometime on Twitch. I stream every Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, usually pretty late at night, but I'd love for you to come and hang out and chat for a bit. So cancel culture. It's a massive thing right now. If you're on social media or following any kind of news accounts, you're probably seeing actors or actresses or different people in the spotlight being canceled. And so I've decided to take my youth group through a series we're calling Cancel Culture. In that series, we're looking at different people in scripture that either were canceled or had the right to be canceled based on culture standards today and how God responded to them. Cancel culture is essentially this, that when someone says something that you disagree with, that goes against the societal norms, when it goes against culture, when it goes against the masses, is that they're gonna turn around and cyber bully someone. They're going to bully them into tarnishing their name, into where no one really wants to be affiliated with that person anymore, essentially ruining them or canceling. Back in my day, we just called it bullying, but I guess we can put a fancy label on it. Anyway, today's message starts with a story about yours truly. Back when I was about 17, I worked at a grocery store called Kroger. You probably have one near you, you've been to one. But I worked there, and I worked there for a while, and I finally made my way into grocery, which means I unloaded the trucks and I stocked the shelves. One night, I was getting ready to get off. I had about 15 minutes, and I was unloading my last truck. It was a milk truck. So what I was doing is I was loading up milk, big, tall things, about 7 foot tall, just stacked with milk crates with 4 milk jugs in each crate. I was unloading them and then loading them into the milk cooler. Now, where the milk cooler was, the floor had been removed at the entrance of the milk cooler, so you'd have to go down about a 2-inch drop and then back up about a 2-inch ledge to get the milk put back away. On this night, I was in a hurry. I'd done this a lot of times, so I was in a hurry. I was trying to get done so I could go home. And I remember pulling it down the ledge, the thump, turning it to the milk cooler and shoving it in there, trying to go pretty fast. As I hit that ledge, it must have just thrown it off just enough that the milk crate started to tilt. And so I jump around and try to hold them up, but I can't quite reach the ones at the top. And they fall over the top of me. And about 30 gallons of milk hit the floor and splash everywhere. In a moment, I am covered in milk. I am standing in milk about 2 inches deep. Remember that ledge I was talking about went all the way around about 2 inches deep. That milk just sat there. It was in my shoes. It was in my socks. It was so, so bad. And so, no, I didn't leave in 15 minutes. I spent about the next 2 hours cleaning up milk. I made a mistake in a moment. In a moment, I was in a hurry and I made a mistake and I had to pay for that mistake. Now, have you guys ever made a similar mistake? Some sort of funny mistake? If so, tell me the story down below. I'd love to hear about it. But I made a mistake. It was simply that. I turned. I went too fast. I messed up. Each and every one of us are guilty of making mistakes, of messing up, of failing in some way. Yet what culture is now saying is that if you make a mistake, now yes, probably more severe than my milk story, but if you make a mistake, if you mess up, then you are going to be ruined and you are going to be canceled. That you no longer have a right to have the position that you have because you're going to be canceled because you simply made a mistake. So many of us make mistakes on a daily basis. I don't know about y'all, but I make a mistake on a daily basis. Yet if I had a massive public platform, I could be canceled, I could be ruined, I could have my life flipped and turned upside down, right? But we all make mistakes. But what does God say about that? As I was looking at this, I was looking at social media, I was looking at cancel culture, and I was looking at how these things are handled, I realized that it all just stems from people making mistakes. Someone did something that, you know, they feel bad about, and it's not that we haven't done the same things, but now because they have a public platform, they are being canceled, they're being ruined. Their name is being so tarnished that people no longer want to be affiliated with them, so they can't find work, they can't find jobs, that their family's embarrassed to be around them, right? Like, it's just not right. And so I thought about this. Where in scripture could we find an example of a mistake? And I can't honestly think of a bigger mistake than the mistake that King David made. So if you're not familiar with King David, let me give you the rundown real quick. David was a shepherd boy, and God chose him to be the king of Israel. A bit later, David went and fought a giant named Goliath and he slayed him. And then David became king of all of Israel. Now, one day while he was king, his army was out fighting. We actually in scripture read that David was supposed to be there with him. He didn't go. He stayed back in his kingdom. While his army was out there fighting on his behalf, he's out there walking around on his rooftop and he looks down and he sees a woman taking a bath. Now, listen to this real quick. It says in 2 Samuel 11, 2 and 3, it says, one evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. And the man said, she is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. So notice this. David sends a messenger to find out about her, and he finds out that she is married to Uriah the Hittite, one of his soldiers that was out there fighting at that very moment. Yet David, even with this information, then sends someone to retrieve her and bring her up to him. When she gets up there, he then sleeps with her, and then later she goes on her way back home. David later finds out that she is pregnant. Oh boy, he's got some tracks to cover. And so what David does is he calls for her husband, Uriah the Hittite, to come back from war. And he says, you fought so hard, I want you to go and be with your wife. Uriah refuses and he sleeps with the servants in a tent because he says, how could I go lay with my wife while my fellow soldiers are out there fighting? So he refuses to go and sleep with his wife. And so David tries again. David gets him drunk and tries to send him home, but again, he refuses. What David does, he then sends Uriah back to battle, but he gives him a letter. And this is how good of a soldier Uriah is. He never opens the letter. He just walks right on back into battle and gives the letter to the commanding officer. Now, had he read the letter, this is what he would have read. In 2 Samuel 11, 15, we get a glimpse at the letter. Put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest, then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die. David knowingly sleeps with this man's wife, impregnates her, tries to get him to sleep with her. When he doesn't, he then has him killed. You do not get much worse than David in this moment. You don't get much worse than David. Yet what does God say about him? Because culture says he is canceled. He is done. He does not deserve a platform. He does not deserve authority. He does not deserve the home that he has given. He does not deserve the life that he has given. And I think you and I, if it happened today, we'd probably agree that he does not deserve what he's been given, but God still calls him a man after his own heart. Yeah, God punishes him. God sets him straight. God tells him that he should not have done that, but God still chose him as the king of Israel. God still set him apart. God still called him for a purpose. God still said he's a man after his own heart, and God still used his lineage to bring forth Jesus who would save the entire world. You see, culture would have canceled him because of his mistakes, but God instead cancels his mistakes. God says, yes, David messed up. Yes, David is flawed. Yes, David made a mistake. Yes, David did horrible, horrendous, despicable things, yet I have called him and I've set him apart. And this is fantastic news for you and I, because you and I are not perfect. We have made mistakes. Where, who are we to judge David when we ourselves have made mistakes? Maybe not to that depth or to that level, but we have made mistakes. We are not perfect. God is perfect. If anyone is suitable to judge David based on his mistakes, it would be he who has never made a mistake, which we can only put God in that role. And God still says, he is a man after my own heart. I have chosen David and I've set him apart. You see, we can have assurance because you and I have messed up. We've made mistakes and we will continue to make mistakes. You see, God has never expected you to be perfect. God has never expected you to never give in to sin. He's never expected you to never give in to temptation. He's always known the mistakes you would make, and yet he calls you to turn to him. You see, later in the Psalms, David says this in Psalms 51, 16, 17, you do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, God, will not despise. Now listen to that. You do not delight in sacrifice. You take no pleasure in burnt offerings. What you look for is a broken and contrite heart. What's that mean? God wants us to feel bad for our mistakes. God wants us to realize and recognize the mistakes we've made. He wants us to turn and repent from those things. That's something that's not talked about a lot anymore is repentance, but it is absolutely necessary. You see, in a lot of today's Christianity, we try to justify our sin. We don't recognize our sin, we justify it. We try to okay it. We try to say, well, I was not in the right mind, or it was just that one time, or it was just because they talked me into it. Or does the Bible even say that? Does this Greek word actually mean this? And really it's talking about this, and I'm probably okay to live how I want to live because God probably didn't really mean that. And how could a loving God mean this? God loves love, and that. We try to justify our sin. Even if we get to where we believe we're not sinning, God still knows what he said, and he knows what he meant, and he knows your heart. And so you can do all you want and justify your sin all you want. It does not make you okay with the big guy upstairs. And so what God looks for is a broken and contrite heart. You repent from your sins means you're facing your sin and you turn and you face God. You turn away from your sin. You do a 180. You turn all the way away from your sin and you pursue God. You're pursuing sin. You're pursuing the flesh. You're pursuing worldly desires and worldly passions, and you give those things up and you pursue God. That is what repentance looks like. If you're in the midst of failure, if you've made mistakes, if you've fallen away, if you don't know where you are in your relationship with God, stop chasing your sin. Stop justifying your sin. Turn and chase after God. Get in the scripture and live like Jesus. Hit your knees and bow down and pray to him. He is not canceling you. He's calling you to repentance. He's not saying, I don't want you anymore. He's saying, son, come home. Daughter, come home. I know what you've done. I know the mistakes you've made. I know what lifestyle you're in the midst of, but I still accept you and I still love you. Turn away from your sin and follow me. Every time Jesus showed up to someone, he would tell them, go and sin no more. He's telling them to repent, turn away from their sin and turn toward him. Guys, I'm begging you today, pursue Jesus. Pursue Jesus, not your sin. Pursue Jesus, not your worldly pleasures. Pursue Jesus, not your desires. Pursue Jesus, not your temptations. Pursue Jesus, not your addictions. It's not easy. It takes a process of choosing Jesus day after day, hour after hour, minute after minute. It's I pursue Jesus and not my mistakes. I pursue Jesus and not my flesh. I pursue Jesus. If you will pursue him, I don't care what you've done. Look at David. He slept with a man's wife. He had the man killed, and yet God called him. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what mistakes you've made, and neither does God. God does not care. He has called you to be his child. Turn away from your mistakes. Quit living in sin and chase after him. Not that you'll ever be perfect, but that you're always in constant repentance of sin and always in pursuit of Jesus. And I believe no matter what you've done or where you've been or what you've been through, you can be saved today, right here, watching this video. It goes through this, believing in Jesus, believing that he laid his life down and he died for you, repenting from your sin and following him. And you can be saved today. That's all it takes. No matter what your mistakes are, no matter what sin you've fallen into, no matter what temptations and addictions you've given into, you can be saved today by turning away from your sin and following Jesus. And if you guys want to talk about that further, I'm going to have my Discord link down below. You can join my Discord. You can message me privately and we can talk through some stuff. I can help you. I'm not perfect. I've made mistakes. God saved me when I was 21 years of age. I made plenty of mistakes up until that point. I've made plenty of mistakes after, but I am trying my best to live in repentance of my sin and turning toward Jesus at every avenue possible. I'm not perfect, but I hope that I can help you guys through that. I do hope this video has been helpful for you. If it is, I'll have plenty of videos like this coming out. I have plenty of videos that I've already made similar to this. Be sure to subscribe to the channel and look out for more. If you want to talk about this, you want to ask questions about this video, you just want prayer about something you're going through, be sure to follow me over on Twitch. I stream every Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday pretty late at night. But guys, I really do appreciate you. And I hope that you do better this week, that if you're living in mistakes, if you're living in sin, that you would be able to read the scripture, that you would open up the Bible, you would realize where you are in life and that you would turn from your sin and you would pursue Jesus. All right, guys, I love you and keep living that bold life.